My name is Natasha Campbell-McBride. I'm a medical doctor. I was born in the Soviet Union, in Russia. I was trained as a medical doctor and neurologist and neurosurgeon there. I've completed a PhD in neurology, and then I moved to the UK, where I have completed a second postgraduate degree in human nutrition. And so now I have these skills to combine the medical and the neurology and the human nutrition skills. And these are all the skills that I use in my clinic. I treat my patients largely by changing their diet, changing their nutrition, and changing their lifestyle, because I find that these are the most powerful modalities for treating modern degenerative disease. We had illness in the family that I had to deal with, and when I discovered that my own profession had nothing to offer to remedy the condition, I was looking everywhere, far and wide, and I found that food is an extremely powerful way of dealing with disease, the most powerful way. Many people don't realize it, just how powerful food is. So I went back to university and I studied human nutrition, and I've studied all the science behind it. And the result of that research, combining with all the other skills that I already had, was that I remedied the family condition. That changed my professional approach to disease entirely. When I worked as a neurologist in the mainstream medicine, I have noticed that most, almost 100% of chronic neurological conditions were people who had serious digestive problems as well. And I wondered why they all suffer from digestive disorders. In the mainstream medicine, it was thought that they're just coincidental, they have nothing to do with their neurological symptoms, and that we just ignore them, or we invite a gastroenterologist to deal with them. We don't have to deal with them. And having learned what I've learned through my own personal experience and with thousands of patients in my clinic now, I realized that it is the digestive disorders that these people have that caused their neurological conditions. And in order to treat these neurological conditions, we have to start from treating the digestive system of these people. The most common neurological conditions that neurologists have to deal with on a daily basis are multiple sclerosis and amyotrophic lateral sclerosis and various neuropathies and various other neurological conditions that people suffer from, where they start getting paralysis and lose the muscle tone and lose their reflexes and lose the strength in the muscles, muscular disorders. Most of these conditions are now being pronounced as autoimmune, where we assume that the immune system of the patient went on a rampage for whatever reason and started attacking the person's nervous system, the brain, the spine, and the nerves, and causing all these symptoms. What the mainstream medicine doesn't seem to be interested in is to find out why does the immune system does all this? Why does the immunity attack people's nervous system? And now through my work, I have no doubt why. 85% of all immune system is located in the digestive tract, in the gut wall of the person. So our digestive system is a huge and the most important and the biggest immune organ in our bodies. And there is a very intimate and very serious conversation going on between that immunity in the gut wall and between what lives inside the digestive tract of these people. What lives inside our digestive system? Our gut flora. An average adult has between 2 and 3 kilograms of microbes inside their digestive tract. And it's a highly organized microbial world where certain species have to predominate in order to keep us healthy and well-functioning. And their functions and their ability to affect our health goes far beyond the digestive system itself. They regulate immunity and they keep the whole of the body together and working together. Recent research in Scandinavia has established the fact that about 90% of all cells and all genetic material in the human body is our gut flora. 90%. So we are just 10%. We're just a shell, a habitat for this mass of microbes who live inside us. And we ignore them at our peril. They ensure that we digest and absorb the food properly. They ensure that our immune system is well balanced and working properly. They ensure that the gut lining is in a good shape and good state, not to let toxins through and microbes through and partially digested foods through. And when the gut flora is unhealthy and abnormal, all these functions fail. The person does not digest and absorb food properly, so they develop multiple nutritional deficiencies. In effect, their body is starving of nutrients. At the same time, the immunity goes on a rampage. It gets unbalanced, autoimmunity develops. All these autoimmune conditions are stemming from the digestive tract, from unhealthy gut flora and unhealthy gut. There are best part of 200 autoimmune conditions already established in our medical science. And our medicine keeps coming with newer and newer diagnostic boxes, which are called autoimmune. Many of them are unpronounceable. Every one of those conditions, I'm absolutely convinced from my clinical experience, are born in the digestive tract of these patients. About 85% of our immune system is located in the gut wall. That is the most important and the biggest part of our immune system. And the relationship and the conversation that goes on between the gut flora and the immune system in the wall is so intimate and so complex. We only just started studying that subject. We only touched the tip of the iceberg. And when the gut flora is abnormal, when it's unhealthy in a person, the immune system simply cannot be healthy. It gets out of balance immediately. And the first thing that happens, usually in children, when this situation develops, the child becomes prone to allergies. The child starts developing allergies to foods, asthma, eczema, hay fever, and various other allergic atopic conditions, because the immune system went out of balance. Major armies in the immune system, major parts of it, Th1 and Th2 immunity, got out of balance. And the child's immune system cannot respond to the environment appropriately, to pollen, to dust, to dandruff from animals, to foods, to industrial chemicals. The immune system is simply unable to respond appropriately. It responds inappropriately to these things, and the person develops allergies, develops reactions. In terms of autoimmunity, what happens in these patients? The immune system is out of balance. As a result, it employs the armies of sensitized cells, Th cells, which are already on the shelf, which already know various proteins in the environment. And when a protein from food doesn't get digested properly and absorbs through the damaged gut lining into the bloodstream, this unbalanced immune system finds these proteins in the bloodstream and attacks them. It doesn't recognize them as food. And the person develops symptoms. This is called a food intolerance or food allergy. And if we talk to the population, if you stop any person on the street, you will discover that quite a large percent of our population have food allergies and intolerances. What's wrong is that their gut lining is damaged. It's like a sieve. The digestive tract is not functioning well because it is full of abnormal, unhealthy species of microbes. So foods don't get the chance to be digested and broken down properly before they absorb through that damaged gut lining into the bloodstream. So in order to get rid of these food allergies and asthma and eczema and various other allergic reactions and hay fever, you need to focus on healing and sealing the gut lining. A healthy person with a healthy gut flora will have so-called probiotic or beneficial species of microbes predominating in our digestive system. They're in the majority. And despite the fact that they're in the majority, there are still thousands and thousands of downright pathogenic, disease-causing microbes right there living alongside with the beneficial flora. But as long as the beneficial flora predominates, it controls those critters and does not allow them to do any harm, and even employs them in providing us with some nourishing substances and converting the foods into some vitamins and other nourishment for us. But when the gut flora gets damaged, when those beneficial species of bacteria get wiped out, the whole situation changes. The pathogens take over. They start dominating in the digestive tract, and they change the digestion, the immunity, and everything else. There are a number of influences in our modern world, in our modern lifestyle, which have a devastating effect on our gut flora. Antibiotics are number one. Since the 50s or 60s, antibiotics has been prescribed for every cough and sneeze to people, given out like sweets. And broad-spectrum antibiotics have a devastating effect on the beneficial microbes in the digestive tract. They wipe them out. While many pathogens are resistant to them, they have no effect on the pathogenic species, such as yeasts, for example, and clostridia, and some other species which are pathogenic. The beneficial microbes do recover. They do manage to restore themselves, but it takes different species between 2 weeks to 2 months to recover. And that's a window of opportunity for the pathogens to flourish, to spread, to occupy large niches in the digestive tract. And once they've occupied those territories, the recovering beneficial flora has a fight on their hands. It's very difficult for them to push those pathogens out of those niches. So from course of antibiotics to the next course of antibiotics, the damage to the gut flora becomes deeper and deeper, and less of the beneficial microbes is left in the digestive tract, and more they're replaced by the pathogens. Another huge factor is the generations. This damage is getting deeper and deeper from generation to generation. Before I talk about the health of the child in my clinic, and quite a serious percent of my patients are children, I always talk about the health of the parents, and sometimes even grandparents. Because as far as science knows, a baby inside the mother's womb is sterile. The baby's body is sterile and the digestive tract is sterile. But as the baby goes through the birth canal, at the time of birth, baby swallows first mouthfuls of bacteria, and that becomes the baby's gut flora. So the gut flora comes from the mom. Where does the flora in the birth canal of the mom comes from? From the mother's digestive tract, from her bowel. So if the woman has got abnormal gut flora, that's what she will have in her birth canal, and that's what she will pass to her baby. And I see it in generations. I see that the grandmother had a few courses of antibiotics after the Second World War, and she had a mildly abnormal gut flora due to that influence. She gave birth to her daughter in 60s and 70s. These are the generation of ladies who are having children now. And she passed this mildly abnormal gut flora to her daughter at birth. That was also the same time when the breastfeeding went out of fashion. And all these commercial formulas came on the market, the baby formulas. Women were generally told that breastfeeding is now old-fashioned, there's no need to do it, you can replace it with the formula. So this generation, quite a large percent of them, were not breastfed. And now we know that breastfeeding, breastfed babies develop completely different gut flora to the bottle-fed babies. And in the bottle-fed baby, their gut flora is more abnormal, and that predisposes them usually first thing and foremost is allergies. They're prone to asthma and eczema and hay fever and all sorts of other allergies, these children. And then other problems come later in these children because right from the beginning of their life, they've acquired abnormal gut flora and it became worse by bottle feeding. Then these girls go on through their life being exposed to one course of antibiotics after another because their immunity is compromised. And then they're fed processed foods. That's the time also when processed foods came on the market, which do not feed the body, they just pollute the body. They do not provide the nourishment for the immune system. They do not provide the nourishment for the nervous system or other systems in the body. So these girls were very prone to colds, to ear infections, to chest infections, to tonsillitis, to all sorts of other problems. And of course, antibiotics are prescribed for all of those problems. And from course of antibiotic to the next course of antibiotic, whatever precious good bacteria these girls have acquired from their moms at birth and managed to preserve during bottle feeding gets damaged further and further and further. And then when they're teenagers, these ladies are put on a contraceptive pill. Contraceptive pill has a devastating effect on gut flora. And these youngsters are put on it for quite a few years. They take it for quite a few years before they're ready to start their family. So by the time these generations of young ladies are ready to start their family, their gut flora is seriously abnormal. And that is what they're passing to their children. They develop autism, they develop ADHD, they develop ADD, and they develop dyslexia, dyspraxia, oppositional defiant disorder, and other learning, behavioral, and social problems which may not fit into any diagnostic box. These are the children with whom pediatricians usually procrastinate. They ask the parents to bring the child again and again for observation after 6 weeks, after 6 months' time. And a very precious time gets wasted when the child could have been helped. where these abnormalities in the mental functioning of the child and the physical functioning of the child are getting deeper and deeper. These children with learning disabilities have very abnormal gut flora. Their gut lining is damaged, it's porous, it's leaky, it's letting through undigested food particles, partially broken down proteins, alive and kicking bacteria, viruses, fungi, and other microbes whistle through that damaged gut lining. And the most terrible thing that happens to these children is that this abnormal gut flora that they acquire from the beginning of their lives starts converting the food that comes along into hundreds and hundreds of very toxic substances, extremely poisonous substances. And these toxins then absorb through the damaged gut lining into the bloodstream of these children and get distributed around the body and get into the brain of the child. Autistic children are born with normal brains. Hyperactive children are born with normal brains. And dyslexic and dyspraxic and all these other children, 99.9% of them have no genetic abnormalities or anything like they were perfectly healthy, normal babies at birth. The digestive tract of these children, instead of being a source of nourishment for the child, becomes a major source of toxicity for the child. And as these toxins flood into the brain, they clog the brain with toxicity and the brain cannot function appropriately. How do children learn? How do babies learn? If you've ever observed babies, you would see that they listen to everything. They stare at everybody. They've got this shameless baby stare when they keep staring at you until they figure you out. And you can see that something's turning in their head. They're figuring you out. Who are you? Why are you here? What are you doing? They taste everything. They touch everything. They take everything into their mouth. What are they doing? Their sensory organs, their eyes, ears, taste buds, tactile sensitivity on their skin and in their mouth, they're collecting information from the environment. And then that information gets passed to the brain. The brain processes this information. And from this information, the baby learns that this is mommy, and this is daddy, and this is a spoon I eat with it. This is a toy I play with it like this. But if the child's brain gets clogged with toxicity, it cannot process this sensory information appropriately. This information turns into a noise, into a jumble, into a mush in their heads. And as a result, the child doesn't learn that this is mommy, doesn't learn that this is daddy. Autistic children are known to pick up a hand of any stranger on the street and walk away. Autistic children don't know what to do with toys. They don't know what to do with utensils. They don't know what to do with other people around. They don't learn the language. They don't learn all the normal behaviors because they cannot derive any useful information from the sensory input, from their sensory organs, because the brain is clogged with toxicity. When the toxicity level builds up high enough in the brain, in some children, the brain develops a cleansing procedure, a safety valve for survival. It sends one electric discharge through and destroys the whole lot of toxins. This is a cleansing procedure. It's a very unfortunate procedure because it manifests as an epileptic seizure. It is caused by toxicity which is coming out of the gut of the child, out of the unhealthy digestive system of the child. And when the level of toxicity builds too high, the brain cleans itself up. That's why people who have epilepsy, schizophrenics, and other psychiatric patients, straight after the epileptic seizure, they are usually more lucid and their schizophrenic symptoms have gone. Psychotic symptoms have gone. But then as the toxicity builds up again, those symptoms return and they have another seizure. So in the vast majority of children, that is the cause. When these children grow up, the first thing that happens quite often is substance abuse. There are two reasons for substance abuse in the youngsters. One is psychological, another one is physical reason. The psychological reason is this: these children grow up and go through schooling and go through all their childhood, being rejected by their peers because they're different, they're strange. They feel at school that they're not doing academically as well as their peers, that they're struggling with academic subjects. And many children on the playground tell them plainly, "You're stupid, I don't want to play with you." So their self-esteem takes quite a battering throughout their childhood. So when they get to the teenage years, they would do anything to be accepted, to have friends, to be invited to the parties, to be wanted, to be involved. And substance abuse is one of the venues that they take quite often. That's the psychological reason, but then there is a physical reason. In order to produce enough neurotransmitters, the brain needs nutrition. And in order to produce enough neurotransmitters, the brain needs to accomplish certain biochemical chains of synthesizing serotonin and dopamine and norepinephrine and many, many other neurotransmitters, endorphins and other. These patients are nutritionally depleted. Their bodies are starving, their brains are starving. They don't have enough nutrition. At the same time, they're very toxic people. So many steps in their biochemical chain of production of neurotransmitters are blocked by toxicity. So they're unable to produce enough serotonin, enough dopamine, and enough of other neurotransmitters. And I believe that we are born and we come to this world to be happy. How do we feel happy? How does the feeling of happiness come? Through producing enough neurotransmitters to the ceiling. It's this top production of serotonin and dopamine and endorphins and other neurotransmitters that gives us that joy of life and that exhilaration and that feeling of success and the feeling of being on top of the world, that we've achieved something, we've done something, we've fulfilled ourselves. These patients can never produce enough neurotransmitters to hit that ceiling. So they never experience that joy of life. They never experience those feelings of exhilaration and achievement, no matter what they've done in life. They just can't quite get up there. Addictive substances such as morphine and heroin and cannabis and sniffing glue and sex and caffeine and tobacco and sugar, it allows them to boost the production of neurotransmitters to reach that ceiling. And the first time these patients experience that, they suddenly realize that's what life is about. Trouble is with addictive substances, the effect doesn't last longer than a few minutes, maximum an hour. And after that, there is a slump which brings them even lower than they were before. And of course, that's where the physical dependency comes. That's where they become hooked physically on these addictive substances to give them that boost, to give them that joie de vivre, as French say. So that's the addiction. The next thing that happens to these patients, they develop depression, the endogenous depression, which is a vast majority of cases, the obsessive-compulsive disorder, the manic-depressive disorder, the king of them all, schizophrenia. These are the most toxic and the most nutritionally depleted patients, and their digestive tracts are an absolute mess in these people. So in order to help this group of patients, we have to start from treating their digestive system. We have to drive out pathogens from the gut. We have to replace those pathogens with beneficial microbes, and we have to heal and seal the gut lining in these people. So the gut, instead of being a source of toxicity in the person's body, becomes the major source of nourishment. So the person starts getting nourished and starts getting cleaned up by the body. And as the brain gets cleaned up, as that toxic fog is removed from the brain, these patients become perfectly normal. They can function. Children can start learning. They suddenly wake up. They suddenly become with you. And I have thousands of autistic children who fully recovered. So what the person eats, the diet, is the most important treatment. Majority of people don't realize and don't even think that food has anything to do with health. Food is the most powerful medicine on this planet. Every clever physician, every clever medic throughout centuries have stated this fact, starting from Hippocrates, who said, let food be your medicine. Let medicine be your food. Food is the most powerful treatment for every degenerative disease in this world. We remove foods which are very difficult to digest and which damage the gut lining and which feed the pathogens in the gut. All those foods have to be out 100%. And we keep in foods which feed the gut lining, rebuild it, restore it, heal and seal it, and which feed beneficial flora in the digestive tract, and which nourish the brain and nourish the immune system and nourish the rest of the body of the person. And as we work on this diet with these foods, the people's the gut flora changes and the gut lining gets healed and all sorts of physical and mental symptoms disappear. Autoimmunity goes away, allergies go away, arthritis goes away, diabetes type 1 disappears. It is an imminently curable condition. Majority of people believe it's incurable. It is perfectly curable, diabetes type 1. And all rheumatoid arthritis and all other autoimmune conditions and the psychiatric and psychological disorders in children and in adults. Talking about the diet, we have to remove all processed foods. These substances have no right to be called foods. They have no right to carry this noble name, food. Only food that Mother Nature has designed and the way Mother Nature has designed it are allowed in the diet. So these people cannot have anything processed because processed foods are full of chemical ingredients, preservatives, colorants, all sorts of flavorings and all sorts of other substances. Plus the natural foods that they were made from initially have been processed, mutilated, chemically altered, changed in such a way that the human body cannot use them anymore. The bulk of processed foods in our world are processed carbohydrates. They're largely made out of grains, which have been processed and changed, out of flour and other grains, and from sugar. These are highly processed substances. They have no place in human nutrition. They do not feed the body. They only pollute it, and they feed pathogens in the digestive tract, and they damage the gut lining, and they are very difficult to digest. They are hard work for the gut lining. So the foods that we remove completely from the diet are all grains and everything that contains them, that is wheat, rye, rice, oats, millet, quinoa, tapioca, couscous, amaranth, the lot. Starch is a large molecule. It's very difficult to digest for majority of people. And in fact, most of it goes undigested. And it feeds the bacteria in the digestive tract. That's its primary purpose. Trouble is that it feeds equally the pathogens and the beneficial flora. So starch feeds the pathogens, so we have to remove it. That's why potato, sweet potato, and all other starchy vegetables have to be out of the diet. So what does the person eat? They eat meat, and they eat fish, and they eat eggs, and they eat fermented dairy products, and they eat all other vegetables, fruit, and nuts, and seeds. The fact that we don't have flour in the diet doesn't mean that they have to be deprived of breads and pastries and cookies and biscuits and waffles and pancakes, whatever you want to make. As long as you use nuts and oily seeds, such as sunflower seeds and pumpkin seeds and sesame seeds, as a flour replacement, you grind them into flour consistency and you use them in baking. And you can bake beautiful breads and beautiful biscuits and beautiful muffins and pancakes and all that kind of produce for these patients. So it's a very rich, nutrient-dense diet. I recommend that people get good quality meats, grass-fed meats, and meats coming from animals, from the breeds of animals that Mother Nature has designed. Many breeds of animals that now used in the modern farming have not been designed by nature. They've been designed in the laboratories by scientists. These are not natural animals. A good example are our milking cows. Most milk that is sold in supermarkets comes from these Frankenstein cows. They are not real cows. They are not the kind of cows that Mother Nature has designed. Where do these cows come from? Well, in the 60s and the 50s, there was a pressure on farming industry to produce more milk and more milk and more milk. And a cow can only produce so much per day. So the scientists were given an order to design a cow that can produce more milk. So they selected sick animals, animals which had a hormonal abnormality. They had an abnormality with their pituitary glands, and these glands were producing far too much growth hormone. So they've selected those animals and they bred from them, and they've designed these special breeds of cows which can produce 3 times more milk per day than a natural cow would be able to produce. And of course, these animals are not natural, they're not normal. Mother Nature has designed the cow to eat grass, and grass alone, and nothing else. These animals cannot survive just on grass. They have to eat grain, and they have to eat soy, and they have to eat synthetic substitutes for food as well. Because if this animal doesn't get enough nutrition to keep feeding that milking gland, she will start breaking down her own bone and muscle to produce milk. These are not natural animals. These are not normal animals. And they're very unhealthy animals. They have arthritis, they have very short life, they live a third of the life, sometimes even less than a normal natural cow would live. And they all have mastitis. Most of them have mastitis most of the time. The recent survey from Bristol University has demonstrated that 75% of these kind of cows in Britain have mastitis at any time. So that means a lot of infection and a lot of pus goes into the milk. And of course, that kind of milk is not clean. It has to be pasteurized. If you have a natural cow, which Mother Nature has designed, and this cow was fed on grass only, on organic green pasture, where not just grass grows, not just the rye grass that many farmers, conventional farmers seed, but it has a varieties of natural meadow grasses, natural alternative flowers and grasses, the way a natural meadow should be. These cows are healthy and they live more than 20 years in a healthy way, and they don't have mastitis and they don't have infections, and their milk is beautiful and healthy, and it has a very different composition to the one that is produced by the Frankenstein cows, which supply all our supermarkets. Pasteurization destroys milk. Milk from any animal, including humans, is the woman's white blood with the red blood cells removed. This is white blood flowing through the milking gland. It's alive. It's got alive immune cells in it. It's got alive blood cells in it. It's got alive active vitamins and enzymes and hundreds of other substances. And it has probiotic bacteria in it, alive probiotic bacteria. Raw milk, unpasteurized milk, is a probiotic food. Always was and always will be. When we pasteurize this product, we kill it. We kill the cells, we destroy the enzymes, we kill the probiotic bacteria, we alter the structure of proteins in the milk, so everybody becomes allergic to it, and we alter the structure of fats and carbohydrates and all other nutrients in the milk, and many vitamins and nutrients get destroyed in the milk after pasteurization. And as if that is not enough, then our supermarkets order the producers to homogenize the milk, because they don't want it to separate in the bottle, because cream naturally rises to the top. And they consider that a problem. It's done purely for cosmetic and commercial reasons, because it's cheaper for them to do that than keep churning the milk and keep mixing it. Homogenization changes the structure of milk even further and removes it even further from its natural state, making it even more harmful to health. Now, there are studies showing that homogenized milk has an ability to cause heart disease and atherosclerosis and many other problems. And there are I've got a stack full of various scientific studies to show that milk causes every disease under the sun. Autoimmunity and cancer and heart disease and diabetes and learning disabilities, anything you like, milk has been implicated. What kind of milk are they talking about? They're talking about this Frankenstein milk, which has been pasteurized, homogenized, and processed further. They're not talking about the raw milk that Mother Nature has designed, from coming from the cows, the breeds of cows that Mother Nature has designed, which ate the way Mother Nature designed them to eat, grass on an organic pasture with variety of herbs in the fresh air. So they're exposed to sun. So there's vitamin D, the sunshine vitamin in their milk. And that's milk from these cows is a great source of vitamin D. We have an epidemic of vitamin D deficiencies in our population. And without vitamin D, we become victims for cancer and diabetes and heart disease and all sorts of things. That's just one aspect of it. We're talking about grass-fed meats coming from natural breeds of animals, not Frankenstein animals. We're talking about pastured eggs, eggs which come from healthy chickens which roam in the fresh air, under the sunlight, and eat natural things, and they're on grass as well. Are we talking about organic fruit and vegetables? Are we talking about healthy, natural nuts and seeds and foods like that? Nutritional deficiencies disappear very quickly. So the brain gets the nourishment, the immune system gets the nourishment, and the rest of the body gets the nourishment. And at the same time, the gut lining gets the nourishment. There's a wonderful process in the human body called cell regeneration. All cells in our body only live a few days. They live very short lives. They fulfill their functions, they die out, and they get replaced by newly born healthy baby cells. Every 3 months, for example, you have a new liver. The liver completely renews itself. All the old cells have gone, and they were replaced by young, new, vibrant cells. If you keep consuming chemical foods, if you keep consuming pollutants and other chemicals, letting them into your body, you will not allow the body to produce healthy baby cells. So if you have some disease in the body, it will be perpetuated. It will not go away. But if you stop that vicious cycle, if you start nourishing yourself properly and stop polluting your body, the body will produce a bunch of healthy baby cells and replace all the sick cells in your body, and your arthritis will be gone, and your cancer will be gone, and your autoimmunity will be gone, and all other chronic conditions and aches and pains that you might have had will be gone, because the body has the ability to do that. It heals you very beautifully. The most active site of cell regeneration is the gut lining. The cells which line our digestive tract only live a few days. They get born at the bottom of the crypts, they travel up the villi, fulfilling functions of digestion and absorption, and then they get too old, too worn out, and they get shed off and replaced by newly born healthy baby cells. So we have a real chance to heal and seal our gut lining. And many, many physical conditions disappear. Farmers have been disconnected from the population because they were classified as commodity producers nowadays. And yet farmers are the ones who lay the ground for the health of the population. It is farmers who are responsible to a degree, responsible for the health of the population. And if you go around Britain nowadays, I walk my dog every day through the fields, and what do farmers largely grow in this country now? It's wheat and sugar beet. What happens with wheat after it's grown? It's ground into flour, and it is the main ingredient in all our processed foods, which should not be called foods. They do not feed the body, they just pollute it. What happens to sugar beet? It's processed, and we make sugar out of it. And that's another major ingredient in all our processed foods. I had a doctor who looked at me and said, how can sugar be bad for us? We've got sugar in our blood. If our medical doctors don't understand that we're really in trouble. What we have to understand, and what these doctors have to understand, that in order for the body to process and metabolize one molecule of sugar, it needs 56 molecules of magnesium. It needs chromium, it needs enzymes, it needs vitamins, it needs amino acids, it needs many, many other nutrients. When you analyze the sugar beet, a piece of sugar beet in a laboratory, for every molecule of sugar, there are 56 molecules of magnesium, and there are the right number of molecules of chromium, and there are those amino acids and enzymes and vitamins and all the other nutrients. It is a whole food that Mother Nature packed together in order for that molecule of sugar to be processed properly by the body and to be metabolized properly in order to do only good for us. But we're not eating sugar beet the way it is, do we? Nobody goes around munching sugar beet or munching sugar cane or anything like that. The same with sugar cane, when we analyze it in the laboratory, it has the full spectrum of nutrients to buffer and to compensate for that molecule of sugar. No, what we do in our factories, we take the sugar out of the beet and sugar cane and we throw all the other nutrients away. So that molecule of sugar, that single molecule, comes into the human body like a villain, like a highway robber. It needs those 56 molecules of magnesium. And it needs that chromium, and it needs all those things. So where do they come from? It robs the body of all these substances. That's what just sugar can do to you. And if you look at the fields in this country, because our government subsidizes production of wheat and sugar, most things that are grown is sugar and wheat. And that's what population is eating. And that's where all these chronic conditions are coming from, the heart disease and the cancer epidemic and the diabetes epidemic and autoimmune conditions and other degenerative conditions. Apart from wheat and sugar, you see these beautiful yellow patches here and there, particularly in June, particularly in the summer. What is that? That is a rapeseed, which is grown to produce oil. Apart from rapeseed, we extract oil from all sorts of vegetable matter. And then these oils are sold in great big bottles as cooking oils and vegetables and supermarkets. And our authorities are telling us that they are healthier and that they should replace the natural fats that we used for centuries, for millennia. The problem with these oils is that they are polyunsaturated. Their chemical structure is very fragile. They are easily damaged by heat, by light, and by oxygen. That's why Mother Nature locked them in the chemical structure, in the very complex structure of the seeds and grasses and nuts and other plants. When we eat them in a natural form, in the form of the seed, when we chew a nut, we get these polyunsaturated oils, unadulterated, unchanged, and they're good for us and they're healthy for us in small amounts. But what do we do industrially? we process, we squeeze them out from these plants and seeds, and we subject those oils to solvents and high temperature and high pressure and to oxygen and to light and to all sorts of things. So the resulting oil are mutilated, chemically distorted, chemically destroyed molecules of oil, molecules of fat, which do not do any good to anybody's body. They do just the opposite. They pollute the body, they damage immunity, they damage nervous system, they damage the heart, they damage the arteries, they damage the liver. These are one of the most harmful things you can put into your mouth. And of course, through all the propaganda, the population is being convinced of just the opposite, that they should use these oils for all their frying and roasting and cooking. For millennia, for centuries, human beings cooked on animal fats, on pork fat and lamb fat and lard and butter and ghee. Whatever culture you look at around the world, people used whatever animal fats were available to them at the time, and they prized them. These were the most prized foods and considered the most healthy foods. And indeed, they are. Because the kind of oils, oily fatty acid molecules that they're composed of are stable and strong, and they do not get changed by heat, by solvents. My grandmother didn't use to wash her frying pan. She reused the fat again and again, and that's a perfectly healthy practice. These animal fats, when we look at their chemical composition, it is very similar to the chemical composition of our own fat in our bodies. They're very compatible with our human physiology. But to go a step further, let's look at the composition of human breast milk. Breast milk is the best food for human baby. And it's a healing food that is legendary. If you look at Greek legends and other ancient legends, that starving people and people who were on the brink of death, when they consumed breast milk, if there was a woman who was breastfeeding a baby at that point, and if she would volunteer to give her milk to that person, they recovered much quicker. Because the composition of breast milk is so beautiful for the human physiology, so healing, it virtually doesn't need digesting. And when we look at the proportions of fats and cholesterol in the human breast milk, it is very similar to lamb fat and beef fat and to lard. It's largely saturated. Then a portion of it is monounsaturated, and only a tiny proportion will have polyunsaturated fatty acids. We all thrived on that composition of fats for millions of years beautifully. Have you ever asked yourself a question? Who educates the population on what we should eat and what we shouldn't eat? Who? To place a 30-second advertisement on TV, you need 15 or 20,000 pounds. Educating the population is an extremely expensive business. Science doesn't have money to do that. Who does? Food industry, corporations. They have the money and they have the motivation to tell the population what they should eat. So they've been educating the population now for decades that all the foods which are unprofitable for them, the population should not eat and they're bad for us, and all the foods which are very profitable for them are good for us. Vegetable oils are highly profitable, extremely profitable. While selling butter or lard is not very profitable at all, because there's not much processing there. It's just, you just melt it out and you sell it as it is. That is why these fats were vilified. I'm sure that many people now thinking about heart disease and cholesterol. Where did that idea come from? We're coming from an idea which was proposed in 1953 first, that fats in foods might have something to do with heart disease. That idea is called the diet heart hypothesis. Any hypothesis is only an idea until it's been proven. Trouble is that it took science decades working on that idea, trying to prove it, and actually what they've done, they've proven it to be entirely wrong, completely wrong. But while all that was going on, while the science was working on this idea, a huge political and commercial machine has grown up on this idea, which is making enormous profits. And the more scientists now are producing evidence to show that this, the diet heart hypothesis, is entirely and completely wrong, the stronger the propaganda becomes coming from food industry and from other corporations and from the governments that they control. because governments are there to serve corporations. And as the governments dictate to the medical profession what to say and what to do, the medical profession is in the same camp as well. They're being educated by the food industry as well. And as a result, the population have heard this idea so much now that vegetable oils are good for you and butter is bad for you. Where just the opposite is true. Butter is a life-giving, health-giving, healthy, beautiful substance which will do your body only good, while vegetable oils cause every disease under the sun, and that has been proven by solid science. Trouble is that science can never have a chance to make it into the mainstream media because it's a very expensive business. And the food industry is not going to pay for that, and the government is not going to pay for that, and nobody is going to pay for that. So those studies are buried in the peer-reviewed journals and available only to scientists. They're not available to the population. I would like to see small mixed farms, the way it used to be before the Second World War. A farm that has crops and vegetables and fruit and animals. In order for the soil to stay alive and stay healthy, it needs animals. So when you've harvested your wheat on your field, you have to let chickens and pigs and cows and sheep on that field. Because with their excrements, they will fertilize the field. They would put probiotic bacteria back into the soil. They will restore the living community of the soil. The soil is a highly alive and highly complex organism. It has trillions of various species of life in it, starting from viruses and fungi and bacteria and insects and protozoa and all sorts of little creatures. And they all have to be there. In our chemical farming, which is insane, the soils which are sprayed and sprayed and sprayed are dead. Many soils are dead. There's no bacteria, there's no life in it left anymore. So these soils cannot sustain the plants. They actually just provide a physical medium to hold the root of the plant in place. That's all they provide. They don't provide the nourishment. The nourishment, the meager nourishment, comes from those white pellets that the farmers spread all over their field, the fertilizers. And all they provide is just a few little minerals to allow the plant to grow. But when you analyze that plant in the laboratory, nutritionally, it's empty. It doesn't have the nutrition that plants used to have even 30 years ago or 40 years ago. So they don't nourish us. They just create nutritional deficiencies, and they don't nourish our animals that are fed on these plants. And the milk as a result is nutritionally deficient, and eggs and meat, and the whole food chain suffers from these practices. When you have small mixed farms where animals are put on the field after the field has been harvested, they will restore the fertility of the soil. So next crop that you put on that field will be well nourished and will have plenty of nutrition in it. So you will be fed well and you will be healthier and happier as a population, and everybody will benefit. The chemical industry has been working very hard on spreading the message across the globe that without us, you can't feed the planet. Without us, you will all starve. Without our chemicals, without our pesticides and so on. There are studies now to show that organic farming produces 3 times bigger yields. 3 times. And of course, the nutritional value of their food is incomparable with the chemical food that this chemical farming is producing. So that's a myth. That's a lie. We can feed the world, and we can feed it much, much better if the food production is made local again and was allowed to manage itself and went back to small mixed farms.